Greetings. Welcome to Into the Light. My name is Donald Schmid, and we're in the studio today with Pastor James Sloven from Wounded Heart Ministry. Welcome,
Thank you, Pastor James.
Our topic today is changed in a flash. You know, sometimes in life, we go through life and we think we're doing the right thing, and we have a personality or a mindset, and we want everybody to do things our way. Today we're going to look at a Jewish man who back in the early days, he was a Pharisee, and he knew everything. And he studied under this teacher whose name was Gamaliel, and he was persecuting anybody who had anything to do with Jesus and the people of the way. So one day they were stoning this guy. His name was Stephen, and Saul approved of his death. So everybody's like scattering around because there's this maniac going around killing all the people, and he didn't like them because he thought that the Jewish way was the only way. And he's on his way to Damascus, and he has an experience, and we're going to pick it up in Acts 9, chapter 1, verse 1. And Saul, still breathing threat and murder among the disciples of the Lord, when he went to the high priest, asked from him letters to the synagogues in Damascus, to the end that if he would find any who were of the way, both men and women, he would lead them bound to Jerusalem. And it happened while he was going, as he drew near to Damascus, a light from heaven suddenly shone around him. And as he fell to the ground, he heard a voice say to him, "Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me?" And he said, "Who are you, Lord?" And he said, "I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting. But you must now rise and enter the city, and it will be told to you what is necessary for you to do." And the men traveling with him had stood speechless, hearing the voice on the one hand, but on the other hand, not seeing anyone. Then Saul got up from the ground, but when he opened his eyes, he was not seeing anything. And taking him by the hand, they were leading him to Damascus. And he was without sight 3 days, and he was neither eating nor drinking. So this was a major upheaval. Here this guy spoke 5 languages. He knew everything. He was kicking the people, everything. He was persecuting them. He didn't care if they were men, women, or kids. And he has the experience, a white light experience, with the creator of the universe. Mm-hmm. And today, Pastor James is going to share with us how he had a transformation from doing things the way of the world, and he had a spiritual experience, and how his life was changed when he received Jesus as his Lord and Savior. Pastor James, we welcome you again to
Thank you.
Into the Light, and could you just tell us a little bit about your story?
I gave my heart to the Lord in March 5th, 1975. My life before that, in my teen years, was a life I was addicted to a drug called pharmaceutical Tylenols. I'm not sure if it even exists anymore. But from the time I was a child, I was addicted to drugs. I was in a house with a very love-starved mother who used to practice witchcraft, reading the cards. She didn't even need tarot cards, my mother. She would read, she would read playing cards. That's how good she was what she did. And then when I gave my testimony many years ago in Brooklyn Tabernacle, I said my father, I had an Irish father and a Sicilian mother, so if you want to be confused, you know. He ran with the Westies. The Westies didn't exist at that time. He was with Irish gangsters. He wound up spending 17 years in jail, 9 years in Sing Sing, upstate New York, and he was going to make the world pay for what he went through. He was drunk 7 days a week. So between him being drunk, my mother practicing witchcraft, having a very, very sick, asthmatic child from birth, it was a crazy house to grow up in. And God had, when I was about 21 years old, after being involved with 2 bouts with an eyewitness to murder, I OD'd once on 19 pharmaceutical Tylenols because the cops were coming across the street, and they told me to drop those pills, and I said things to them that are not in the New Testament, and I just ate all of them. And God, and I said this one time when I was preaching, and I don't want to be melodramatic. When I was in that state, all I know, I was in the blackest darkness I've ever seen. I was peaceful, but I don't think I was completely dead, and God in his great mercy revived me. And from that day on, my life began the transformation, where through a lot of, I gave my testimony in Brooklyn Tabernacle 16 years ago, and you're putting 25 minutes into 25 years. But my mind, all the drugs stopped, but my mind had to renew, the renewing of the mind. And as a Christian, for years and years, I was slipping and sliding. I have three children, Richard, James, and Denise Sloven, and I put them through a lot. I was a good father in one way, but I was terrible in another way. But you know what I've learned painfully, because I speak to mainly to people in addiction today? God doesn't look at us the way people do. And it's sad to say this. I guess I'm saying it publicly now. The people that gave up on me first were the church people. I had a time when I was what's called being backslidden, where I was back in as Christians say, in the world. I was snorting cocaine. I destroyed my marriage. I hurt everybody around me. And sad to say, the church gave up on me. But God doesn't give up on us. He's not like people. Mm-hmm. He sees the beginning and the end, and he restored me. And eventually, by God's grace, a few years ago, I became an ordained minister with the Independent Assemblies of God International. It's a long title. Mm-hmm. And I work with prayer stations in the streets, preaching on the streets to people, working mm-hmm. with people in addiction, in Anchor House, Teen Challenge. And we're just going to see in the days to come what God has.
It's amazing how there's a verse that said, I knew you before you were in your mother's womb.
Amen. That's right.
And I set you apart, and he set us apart. And the thing that the enemy tries to do is fear tells us you'll never amount to anything.
That's right.
And growing up in a household with a dark cloud, with a heavy cloud, with mommy and daddy, practicing their own thing, it was real difficult to get a perception of reality.
Or what's normal.
Yeah. And then the Lord comes in and plucks you out and takes you out of the darkness and you mentioned transformation. And it says in various versions of the Bible, it says, don't be conformed to the way of the world.
Amen.
But be transformed by the renewing of the mind. And the way we renew, it's like, what did God say about us? Our parents said one thing, we hung out with friends, we had corrupt companions,
definitely.
We became corrupt, we didn't have any wise counsel, and now we're the wise counsel. So it could only be an act of a living, loving creator who knew us and said, I can use you, because we were persistent in our addiction and in our affliction.
That's right.
And when we reached the end of the rope, and there was no way out, but there was a way up. And when Saul got knocked off his horse, he was a tormentor.
He was a killer.
Yeah, and a murderer. And later on, he would go on to write 2/3 of the New Testament.
That's right.
So what the enemy means for harm, God means for good. And if you're sitting there and you have a story and you're saying, wow, you're reading my mail and everything, God has a way of getting you where you need to be when you need to be there, so you can hear what you need to hear. Because faith comes by hearing,
and hearing
by the word of God. So we said a lot of things out in the streets when we were out there, and a lot of them are expletive deleted. But
that's right.
And yeah. I've been delivered from pornography, profanity, and assorted addictions, and sit before you a free man.
Amen.
So it's really good to, I've heard you a few times, and you speak from the heart. And the whole thing is, God comes in and rips our stony heart out, and he takes it out, and he puts back a heart of flesh. And any scarring that comes as a result of our childhood and the adolescence has been removed, and now we have the Father heart of God in us, with compassion and patience and kindness and forgiveness and mercy. And that's like a foreign animal.
That's right.
You know, because I had two sets of cards, three sets of dice, a racing form, a can of beer, and once in a while, a pint of pork fried rice, because when somebody told me there was such a thing as shrimp fried rice, I thought he was lying because we couldn't afford shrimp fried rice. So we had pork fried rice. So I thought he was pulling my leg. So when I found out that you could have shrimp fried rice and I had more money, I got shrimp fried rice. But he knows where you're at. He knows what you're going through. It's as simple as just believe in your heart and confess with your mouth that Jesus died for you and you have another chance. And he took every sin yesterday, today, and forever, past, present, and future. So we're like Snow White and Mr. Clean, like wrapped up all in one.
Amen.
You know, and when he gives us his heart is that none be lost. And none means none.
That's right.
You know, so we go after him. You know, Pastor James goes to the streets. I go wherever. I go to the homeless community on Staten Island. I do what I can. You know, I say a prayer almost every day. It's, Lord, show me where to go and tell me what to say. And he gives us the words. Like, up until a few minutes before the camera went on, we weren't really tight on what was going to happen. But then the Spirit of God comes, and because we have the Word of God in our hearts today,
amen,
and we don't have all that malice and garbage, we can, he says, put me in remembrance of my Word. And this is his Word. And if we have his Word in our heart, he says, my word shall not return to me void, but it shall accomplish everything that I sent it to do. So when we say his word and we say it out loud, we'll get the results. It's Isaiah 55:11. You know, there's promises in the Bible. I'll never leave you or forsake you. With the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus.
Amen.
So when we stop confessing our mess, and our mess becomes a message, can you tell us a little about the message and the good news of the gospel and how we reach addicts and alcoholics, and how's that going for Wounded Heart?
Well, you know, on the streets, when you're on the streets with prayer stations, you see people from every walk of life, from every stature, every color, everybody. And, you know, everybody, you know, and I've never in 41 years of being a Christian, I've never seen people more broken than I do now. Unnerved. As a matter of fact, I was writing one of the on Something to Consider. My friend writes for them, and he talks to the heart about what people are going through. And today, whether I've prayed with people on the streets that are wearing $3,000 suits, lawyers, people that are homeless, everybody is feeling a pain like I've never seen before. I grew up in the 60s when things were wild, when the hope, I guess, of this country with John F. Kennedy, Robert Kennedy, Martin Luther King were killed. We were in war in Vietnam, and soldiers are coming home and we're spitting on them. And I thought that was bad as a child, but now, it's not like you can get on a train or a bus wondering if you're going to be murdered by terrorists. This is a different day. And it's been the last days, generally speaking, for 2,000 years. But I believe in my heart, I was just talking to another brother about this, these are the last days. I think we're on the cusp of eternity. A lot of people don't want to hear that, but mm-hmm. I'm excited about that.
Yeah.
You know, I'm excited for my children, my grandchildren. Jesus is going to come and put things right.
Mm-hmm.
You know, as dark as the day get, as the days get in the future, I think we're going to be a greater light.
Mm-hmm.
And I believe a great manifestation of the gifts of the Spirit are going to come mm-hmm. like it did in the first century. Even though there's a lot of charlatans on TV, but a lot of nonsense and yeah. things like that, there's still the real.
The enemy comes to steal, kill, and destroy, and Jesus came to give us life more abundantly. And the enemy knows his time is short.
And that's right.
So he's like Emeril Lagasse, like kicking up a notch, you know, like bam.
Right.
You know, and he's getting division to come in, and you know, the people divided and everything, and he's causing wreaking havoc and everything, and we're coming up, you know, on America making a choice.
That's right. On this election
going yeah. forward, and it's important to vote. But it's also important to seek God and who to vote. Like, nobody can tell anybody who to vote for.
Sure.
But it's so dark that the people who walked in the darkness, Saul was blind for 3 days, have seen a great light. And that great light is Jesus, light of the world, mm-hmm. who came down into darkness, and he resides in our heart, which was a very dark place. You know, I was like, I'd work nights, and I'd work overnights, and I'd take stuff to stay awake, and I go work a second job, and, you know, I had white pills and blue and red pills, and, you know, I had beer to come down, I had pills to go up, right, I didn't know which way was up, and they were expensive and everything. It was 697s and 888s and bootleg Black Beauties, you know, and angel dust, and it was interesting, and it was real, and it was real interesting. But a mind is a terrible thing to waste, and there's been insanity and mental illness in my family, and I'm the first generation to say no to prescription drugs, because there was a time in my life where I was taking 80 milligrams of Prozac to stay awake, and I was taking 60 milligrams of Remeron to go to sleep, and I was a Christian, and I felt like I was doing something wrong. But the doctors and the pharmaceutical companies tell you it's okay, because it's going to fix your mood. You know, and I woke up on July 17th, 7/17, 1999. It was 9:35 in the morning. I remember like it was yesterday. And I said, Lord, you made the earth in 6 days. Please fix the serotonin level in my brain. Have a nice day.
That's right.
And from That's that day good. Forward, you know, it's impossible to please God without faith. And if he says, I'll never leave you or forsake you, I believe he'll never leave me or forsake me. If he says, trust in me with all your heart and don't rely on your own understanding, I believe if I trust him, he's going to give me the wisdom to go forward, to say, to give a word of wisdom or a word of knowledge to somebody who I've never met. I was in a church service on a Wednesday night in Manhattan, and the Lord says, leave now. And it was over like downtown by Fulton Street, mm-hmm. by Broadway. And I'm on the A train, he says, sit over there. And a Muslim woman comes in, and we start talking. She was working at a health food store. The Lord gave me an open door. And we start talking, the stops are going, she's gonna get off at Euclid, I'm gonna get off at Rockaway Boulevard in Queens. In Ozone Park, and we're having a nice conversation, you know, kids and everything. And I says, what does your husband do, you know, for a living? And she looks me in the eye. I never saw her before. And she says, you tell me what my husband does for a living. And I'm like, okay, Lord, you're up. Because it could have been 1,000 different things.
Sure.
You know, so I got quiet. You know, it's noisy on the train. And he says to me, tell her husband's an engineer. And I says, your husband's an engineer. And she went ballistic. She said, how'd you know my husband's an engineer? I never saw you before. She's going up to all the people sitting down like, he knew my husband was an engineer. That gets people's attention.
Sure.
When Jesus was here, the blind saw, the lame walked, the deaf heard, and the dead were raised back to life.
That's right. That was part of the gospel.
Because we're in the last of the last days, prophets and apostles have been missing from the picture. There's a lot of pastors, there's a lot of teachers, there's a lot of evangelists. But we're living in an unbelieving world who needs something supernatural and unbelievable.
Oh, absolutely.
So if somebody dies on Forest Avenue, and the paramedics are looking for time of death, it's like, get out of the way and let Jesus take over. You know, have you had any experience with near-death experiences with people coming back, or how somebody was desperate or drunk and sobered up in a hurry? Or
I've had a few experiences in my life with that, especially when you come from an occultic background like I did. You know how much the light is real, how much the power of God is real. I seen that with my mother one time. My mother had a cancer growing into her chest. A lot of people gave up hope. I was praying in the house, and I was exhausted because my job became then of taking care of two. My father and mother were sick. That I was working in construction for over 20 years. That's the hardest job you'll ever do, taking care of two sick elderly people. But when that happened, she was running back and forth into the hospital. My nerves were shot, and I was praying for her, and they rushed her out again. And I just pulled the phones out because my nerves were so bad, and the devil was attacking me in my mind, as he will, and telling me what a great prayer war you are. Your mother's going to die of cancer. Finally, I put the phone back in. The doctor called me, and he spoke to me very blunt. Maybe he came from Brooklyn, too. I don't know.
Yeah.
He said to me, "Jimmy, don't be in a hurry to put your mother in the box. The cancer's gone." And I said, "I got to go." I just hung the phone up. I was crying hysterical. And me being the way I am, I even took her back to chemo. And the chemo doctor says, "Your mother doesn't need chemo no more. The cancer's gone." My mother died cancer-free.
Yes.
When my middle son, James, was in my mom's hospital, he was a little boy. I was saved about 2 years. There was an epidemic in Brooklyn in Mamamity's hospital. Babies very, very sick. And the Lord told me, go tell that lady that I'm going to heal her daughter and go pray for all those babies in that room. And I felt my pride got the best of me. I was holding back. But I did it. I walked toward it and I did it. And I think about 3 days later, that broke and my son and all those children were touched.
Yeah.
See, what we're talking about, people either reject, it's taught against, the gifts are not extant no more. That's a lie. And as a younger man, when I didn't understand these things, I agreed with them. No, the gifts are real, and they're going to be and I believe they're going to be restored to the church. And there's never been a time in history where people don't need to be touched supernaturally, because they're so turned off for what they see for Christianity today.
Yeah.
By their churches or what they see on TV, these money grabbers always asking for money all the time.
Yeah.
They have a saying, you can never argue with a man or woman that had an experience.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I sang it for the last 40 years. He touched me. So,
mm-hmm.
Amen. Yeah.
Yeah, there's power in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
To break every chain. And one day, every knee is going to bow.
That's right.
And every tongue is going to confess that Jesus is Lord.
Amen.
And I was working the overnight. I was working from 4 to 12. And I was a doorman on 24th and Lexington. And I'm coming home. And if I get off the back of the train, I can walk up Cross Bay Boulevard. But if I get off the front of the train, I can go up 96th Street, and it's dark, but I can get there quicker. So it's about 1:15 in the morning. I look over my shoulder, and two blocks away, there's like one guy walking on the other side of the street. And the next thing I know, it was April 6th. 1995 or something. And next thing I know, I'm surrounded by three guys. And they said, take your hands out of your pocket. You know, give us all you got. And I screamed, help! And you're not supposed to scream help. and the guy said, shoot him. You know, and I said, Jesus! And a car came down the block, hitting the horn. They scattered. I didn't get shot. I don't know if they had a gun or not. It's not. There's just power in the name of Jesus.
I believe that. That's
they
right.
Scattered. The car went down the block. I walked towards the car because they were waiting for me to see if I was okay. I got in the car. It was a woman who I had met 10 years prior in the community, in the neighborhood, and they were both Christians. I called the cops. They said, yeah, there's a lot of that going on. They said, you should carry a lot of singles in your pocket to give to them and everything, and don't give them a hard time. They were doing laundromats and everything, and,
sure.
and they got caught a short time later. But I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, because it's the power of God unto salvation for the Jew first and then for the Gentile.
Amen.
So the amazing grace, how sweet the sound, that saved two guys like us. We once were lost, but now we're found.
That's right.
Paul was blind, Saul was blind, but then he saw, and when he saw the light, he had the same amount of zeal for the gospel that he had for the persecution against the gospel.
He was a changed man.
So you can change in a flash, you know, and it's... It's really cool. We could sit here for hours, and you know, just swap stories. But it's real. You know, he was fully God. He was fully man.
That's right.
He needed the Holy Spirit when he was here. He didn't do anything unless he was told to do it. He was in places sometimes with his disciples, and he says, I'm not going yet. And then as soon as they left, the Father said, okay, now go. So he would go like right after that. And then the first miracle he ever did was at a wedding.
Right, at Cana.
And his mother said, they ran out of wine. And he said, woman, my time hasn't come yet. But Mary, she was a prayer. Somebody comes tells you, you're going to carry the Son of God.
That's right.
To full term by the Holy Spirit, they're going to think you're whacked out. You know, I don't know what kind of hallucinogens they had back then, but she was engaged to a husband, and he could have disowned her or had a stone under Jewish law. But she believed, and she said, do whatever he tells you to do. And in that moment of that faith, when she took that faith, the Father said, that's the faith that unlocks the door to your ministry. Now you do what she needs. And he did it, and they had these big...
the big vats of wine.
55, 60 gallons. They had like 6 or 8 of them. And it was the best wine that they ever had.
The best was saved for last.
They saved the best for last. And we're in the last of the last days, and the Holy Spirit, he's knocking on the door of your heart, and he's saying, I stand at the door and knock. Will you let me in? Will you let me have communion with you? Will you let me have supper with you? Will you take me as your Lord and Savior? And it's that simple, you know. Can you... in about 40 seconds, could you just tell us a little bit about what the Lord has put on your heart?
My heart now is to really preach the gospel. I'm believing more with signs and wonders following. And I'm hoping, if God opens the door, to go to South America. That's where my heart, that's the next big move I think I want to do.
Yeah. You know, it's really exciting because he told me like 18 years ago I was going to Africa. And I never went to Africa. And in February, I had a near-death experience, and I knew I couldn't die because either God was a liar or his promises were true. And so I made it, and I met a pastor from Nigeria at a convention, and I got invited to Nigeria.
That's great.
I was looking for ways to get there, and he has it's called Abba House. He was on our last show, and I'm going, and I don't know when, I don't know how, I don't know why, I don't have to know. I know the one who knows everything.
That's right.
And we want to thank you for watching the show today. And, you know, changed in a flash could happen to you. It happened to Pastor James. It happened to me. God is no respecter of persons. Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He loves you as much as he loves us. He's got a plan and purpose for your life. And we hope to see you next time on Into the Light. Thank you for watching. Have a blessed and safe day. We love you. God loves you. Thank you for tuning in.
How'd that go?